This is the Legislative Report. I'm Laura Mano, joined today by Senator Jesse Hamilton, who represents the 20th Senate District in Brooklyn. Now that the state budget has passed, lawmakers are focused on their priorities for the end of session. Senator Hamilton is with us today to talk about his. Thanks for joining us, Senator.
It's always a pleasure to be here, Laura.
Nice to see you again.
Yes.
So tell us about some of your priorities for the remainder of the session now that the budget has passed.
One of my priorities now the budget has passed, we have an on-time budget this year, which is great. Making sure that the city and state has the funding to fund the agencies that need the money to provide services for the state. And one of the things we're looking at is the paid family leave. Right now, we do have the federal paid family leave act, which gives you 12 weeks, but you don't get paid. And a lot of times, you might have an unforeseen illness in the family, your wife or your child, and you might not have the insurance you need. A lot of folks are not in unions, and you have to, choose between paying your mortgage or paying for health care for a loved one. And that's a decision that I don't think anybody should have to go through in their lives. You know, if having a sick wife, my wife was sick with both of our children, and I looked at the medical bill, and it was $80,000. And I said, oh, my God, well, how could I pay this? So the Paid Family Sick Leave Act is great. To have, so even if you don't have the insurance, you know that you can still pay your rent and buy food for your family. So that's something that I think we should be able to pass. It's the right thing to do. Many families are struggling now in the state, and by having that, it's a safety net. It's a safety net saying that if your child or if your wife gets sick, that you will be able to provide for your family. And so this year, I hope this is the year that families throughout the state can sleep at night knowing that if a loved one were to get sick, they can take time off to take care of that loved one.
Now, I know that it was your intention and your conference's intention to include paid family leave in the budget, and that did not happen?
Right, it did not happen. Sometimes to have an on-time budget, some of the harder issues have to be put off to make sure the budget is done on time. And the governor has been consistent in getting that done. And now it's the negotiating process for the hard issues, the Family Leave Act, the DREAM Act. And so I believe this year many of the state senators are looking at the long-term stability of our state. And in doing so, the Paid Family Leave Act is one of the priorities in the New York State Senate.
Another issue that you had spoken about a lot during the budget process and before the budget even began was increasing the minimum wage. That was another issue left on the table. Is that something that you're focused on trying to do now that the budget is over?
Yes. As you know already, Laura, my district goes from Sunset Park to Park Slope, Gowanus, Prospect Heights, Crown Heights, Flatbush, East Flatbush, and Brownsville. Brownsville being one of the lowest per capita income in the state of New York. And the minimum wage right now, people are bringing home, you're working every day and bringing home $1,300 a month. When you take out taxes, you're down to $1,100 a month. When you take out your monthly Metro card, you're below $1,000 a month. And you haven't even bought food yet. And when you purchase the food, you're down to $500 for rent. Anywhere in the state, you can't afford to live for $500 a month in rent. But in my district, a studio apartment now is going for $2,000 a month. So for a single mother trying to make it, you have to have a minimum wage, at least $15 a month in order to make it. That's, you bring home $2,400 a month. And that's something that, is reasonable. And it's unconscionable that many people now who are working every day, who work in retail stores making minimum wage, have to get food stamps, and have to go on Medicaid. And but you have employers who are making millions of dollars, having great vacations, great homes, sending their children to the best schools, and the workers who are providing the income for them to live this affluent lifestyle are living in shelters. And so right now, my district, we have a lot of new housing going on. And this new housing is called the shelter, where there are no kitchen facilities. Kids have to go to bed hungry at night and go to school in the morning hungry. So the minimum wage is important. It's something to raise up the people who are living in shelters, who are trying to make ends meet, and by doing so, we will increase the economy with the multiplying effect. Because people who make $15 an hour are buying more food. That's the basic essentials, and so that's something that we have to do.
Great. Now, you've also long been an advocate for young people, both in your district and across the state. Were there any items in the budget that would help the youth with either getting jobs or any other programs specifically for young people or anything you're focused on doing for the remainder of session?
Yes, we had the urban youth jobs with $20 million allocated to it. And we're trying to be proactive in looking at it. Right now, to incarcerate someone in New York State is $60,000 a year. That's a lot of money. And in my Brownsville section of the district, we have million-dollar blocks. And when we say million-dollar blocks, these are not million-dollar homes. These are million-dollar blocks where $1 million or more is being spent from the city, state, and federal government, either on subsidies for housing, subsidies for incarceration, as far as incarceration. And so we feel that rather than spending all the money on the front end, we should spend it, on the back end, we should put it on the front end. And by giving youth jobs, give them incentive to go out, to learn job skills so they can be viable citizens in our community. Right now, we have 80% of our prison population doesn't have a high school diploma. So if we know that to be a fact, we should make sure that every child is on par in grade level. And we're introducing legislation to make sure that if a child is one grade behind in reading and math, they have to get supplemental education to bring them up to grade level. Right now, we have a program in the district called the Dream Program, and they reject, Laura, 80% of the applicants who are trying to get their GED. So you have these young men and women, 17 to 22, who might have made mistakes in their lives, who realize now they have to get a GED in order to get a job, and they're being denied. 80% of those children, young men and women who are applying, are denied because they're reading at the seventh grade or below grade level. So something's wrong with the educational system in the state, because right now only 15% of the young men and women of color are ready for college. So we have to go back, and I'm on the education committee, to make sure we have safety measures or checks to make sure that when a child gets one grade behind in reading or math, they get the supplemental help they need in order to come on the par.
Can you explain how the DREAM Act, which was also left out of the budget, would help youth in your district, and if that's something you're also working towards?
Oh, yes. In my office, every other day, someone comes in who's undocumented. And these are hardworking young men and women who want to go to school, and they can't get the financial aid they need. And so even here in the Capitol, there was a woman who had a 4.0 average. She finally got someone to give her a grant, and she did get through the process of education. But as I was saying before, if these young men and women are doing well in school and they're going to be productive people in our society, why not give them the funding to do so? Because if they're making money and they're paying taxes, they'll pay more taxes. So it's not like these young men and women and families aren't paying taxes. They pay taxes every day.
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, another issue that was also left out of the budget that your conference was fighting for what that has to do with young people is raise the age. Can you discuss that proposal and what your feelings are on raise the age?
I think raise the age is a great idea because right now you have 16-year-olds who are being put in prison with people, much older than them. A 16-year-old, mentally they're not an adult, physically they're not an adult. And a lot of these young men and women who do go into the criminal justice system, a lot of them are sexually assaulted, a lot of them are bullied and beat up, and a lot of them have a high recidivism rate for those who are incarcerated at 16, and also a high suicide rate. So raising the age to 18, you take them out of the criminal justice system, you put them into family court, and there are more resources there to help them become viable citizens in our community. So raising the age was a great idea for young men and women to be productive in our society.
What about affordable housing issues in your district? You touched on this a little bit when you spoke about the minimum wage, but is this also something that you're working towards now that the budget has passed? Was that addressed in the budget, and what more would you like to see done with affordable housing in your district?
Yes, affordable housing is a major component. We have the highest homeless rate right now in my district. People just, they're working every day, but the rents are just too high. So we need to have more affordable housing. We talked to the mayor's office, Mayor de Blasio. They have a lot of vacant land left. Well, the last of the vacant land in New York City is going to be not auctioned off, but they're asking for how to use it. And I believe that we need to have mixed use. We can't have a high density of low-income people living in the same area, but we need to have something where you have, you know, market rate, affordable, and low-income housing all together with retail. You know, retail on the first floor, maybe medical offices on the second floor, and this way you can stimulate job growth in the community. You can stimulate just people having a place to live and feeling good about living in a mixed-use community. So right now, we've allocated $100 million for NYCHA to make sure that the repairs are done. We're looking at developing the NYCHA land with mixed-use housing. And so that's a major component. The issue is whether unionized, non-unionized, and rezoning. Mm-hmm. We have to go up vertically, at least 20 more stories to make it truly affordable. For upstate New York, you know, we have a lot of land. Even in the capital, we have a lot of land. But in New York City, literally every piece of land is being utilized for real estate purposes.
Right. Now, are there any other local bills or other legislative priorities that you're focused on for the rest of the session?
One thing we're looking at, the tenant harassment bill. Right now, the DA in Brooklyn, Ken Thompson, arrested two landlords who went into an apartment and just trashed the apartment, took out the kitchen, took out the bathroom, and the person was out of the house for a year and a half.
Wow.
So right now, the DA's office is getting aggressive, and we're going to follow suit with that, with legislation on the state level, to make sure tenants don't live in fear of being, forced at their house. And that's happening a lot now to seniors who live in rent-stabilized buildings, where the rent on the market rent could be $3,000 a month, they may be paying $700 a month. Lenders are becoming very aggressive because they've taken out mortgages on the building. They have a high debt ratio, mm-hmm. and they're unable to pay the mortgage because they fraudulently put down the higher rents. And so we're looking at also of the DA's office to make sure that if you file for a loan with the bank, it must correspond with the actual rent that you're getting from the tenants, not, you know, fudging the numbers to make sure you can get a higher mortgage, but then you have to evict the tenants illegally from the building.
Well, it certainly seems like you have a lot of work ahead of you in your district. Now that you will be spending more time post-session, you'll be obviously back in your district full-time and won't be coming up to Albany as much. Can you let your constituents know what they can look out for that will be coming from your office?
Oh, yes. Please call my office, 718-284-4700. This summer we'll be having concerts. We'll be having also job fairs. In the community, we'll be having health fairs in the community. We'll have the battle of the DJs in the community. We're going to be having the Senior Olympics in the community. So we're doing so many things in our community. And please go to my website, jessehamilton.com, or to my state address, email address, website rather. And we're going to have a fabulous summer. Please come by. We're going to enjoy the summer together.
Great. Well, that's all the time we have for today, but I appreciate you being here, and good luck at the rest of your legislative session.
And you too. Thank you so much, Laura.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks for watching the Legislative Report. For more information on Senator Jesse Hamilton and all he's doing in your area, please visit hamilton.nysenate.gov.